grass doesn't bear any recent footprints. The hovercraft has been reduced to a mound of twisted wreckage. Everything that was straight is bent. Everything that was bent is benter. There appear to be no salvageable parts. You hear a high-pitched beeping sound coming from somewhere inside the wreckage. You didn't notice it during the flight. It must have come on as a result of the crash. A small device resembling a battery rests in the ship's innards. It doesn't smell like much.
Youch! Yes, that still has energy. Perhaps you should find a better way to test these things.
You carefully remove the piece of unstable ordnance and pocket it. Doing so causes the high-pitched beeping to stop.
For some reason, I got this sense of doom right before taking that.
Ouch! That looks painful.
Leave the guard alone. He has been through a lot. The guard appears to be less thick than you remember him. Many of his formerly contained body fluids seem to be at large. Search the grotesque body and find a small, thin magnetic card. It looks like a key card. You seem to recall seeing one somewhere in the past. You detect no unusual fragrance. At least not yet. Soon, though, these bodies may be generating some serious bouquet. You're one twisted mofo. The only other person I know who would try that is Mark Crow. Startle a small creature. It could be a rabbit, but for its green fur and orange spots. Aside from their enormous size, they appear to be your average garden variety mushrooms. It's a good listener, and that's about it. The mushrooms smell like fungus. You can't eat these mushrooms, Roger. Holy jeez, boy! That mushroom thing sucked you clean up! You can't move a muscle nor see a speck of light. You begin feeling waves of tingling warmth and moisture. Suddenly, it's not so bad in here. Wow, check out the colors, dude! Your body and mind enjoyed the short-lived buzz that is a side effect of the lethal poison you now marinate in. You are oblivious to the end. Not a bad way to go, actually. But it sure is early in the game. I had high hopes for you. They said, who? Roger Wilco? Not a chance. That chump won't last 20 minutes. I said, no way. Roger isn't that lame. So anyway, don't make me look stupid, too. The startled bunny has fallen into the formerly concealed pit. You peer into the hole and see the formerly alive bunny, now a mangled corpse, on the end of some large sharpened sticks. You reach into the deep dark hole and pull out the bunny. How the hell did you do that? That hole is obviously longer than your arm.
I guess realism isn't a concern here in the future.
There is nothing else of use in the pit. The smell is that of freshly turned dirt.
Let's not and say we did.
You hear something. That was a tense moment. Vohal's thug failed to spot you and is off to search elsewhere.
forest is disturbingly quiet. You expect it to burst to volume with the sounds of life at any moment, but only rarely is there an insect or forest creature seen. These odd trees grow increasingly smaller in diameter, tapering to a small point at the top. This tiny tree has not grown to nearly the height of its two brethren here, but already it shows the uniquely characteristic traits of these trees. You reach down and feel the tree, then find yourself struggling to free your hand from it. Though the slick adhesive substance doesn't look nearly as thick as the coating on the two larger trees, it can still hold a being helpless quite effectively. This is uncool. It looks like you've adhered yourself to this tree like a fly to flypaper. And speaking of insects, here comes a swarm now. You'll be proud to know that you have filled today's nutritional requirements for many of the local carnivorous insects. Adventuring is not always pretty. The spores are light blue and bulb-shaped. They seem to be loosely attached to the ground. You take possession of one of the spores, being careful not to mistakenly break it open. You seem to have kicked one of the strange little spores. Your kick caused some spores to open and spray a fine powder into the air. As a result, you are paralyzed from head to toe, unable to move a single muscle. Fortunately, the paralysis wears off and you seem to be back to normal. The mailbox looks typical for a mailbox. There is a slot, a tray, and a sign.
The sign says, Radical Express, when it totally no doubt for sure has to be there a while previously.
This is an order form you removed from a magazine for a free Labion Terror Beast mating whistle. It's ready to be mailed. You drop the order form into the box. The mailbox hums and buzzes for a while, then an object of some sort drops into the tray at the base of the box. The machine goes silent. The tray, which is actually a small indentation in the lower part of the machine, is currently bearing what looks to be a whistle. You take the whistle, obviously. Thanks to super advances in technology, mail transporters have the capacity to smell like anything. In fact, for a short period of time, they smelled exactly like what was decided by an intergalactic consortium to be the most fantastic fragrance in the known universe. The mailboxes were so popular that people would schedule their days around using the mail, and running to the mailboxes became the most desired menial task in all offices around the 15 civilized galaxies. Unfortunately, the resulting increase in mail flow caused a catastrophic slowdown in mail services. When they contacted the Great Blue Bureaucrat about increasing the resources of the intergalactic mail, he uttered three guttural noises from his posterior. Those noises translated into the words, "This is further proof that making the customer happy is nothing but a dangerous disruption to business." Confused by this declaration at first, it was eventually decided that the only sensible course of action was to remove the amazing fragrance from all mail transporters. Since then, they have all smelled vaguely of either annoyed impatience, bloated bureaucracy, or sandalwood. Though the Intergalactic Post Office slogan is, in fact, "If you don't like it, bite me," you doubt they meant it literally. Thanks to some fancy footwork, you are now picking yourself up off the ground after surviving a fall down a small cliff. The little creature caught in the snare has thick-looking pinkish skin. He looks to be less than a meter tall. He doesn't seem too thrilled with this predicament. You don't want to get that close to the little dude. What do you think this is, Lover's Leap? He doesn't respond. You quickly untie the little guy. Before disappearing through a tiny hole in the brush, the little pink dude gives you a long look. There's nothing interesting on the front of the tree itself.
Ow!
You feel some corrosive acid on the bark of the tree. The tree smells like a tree. You're not a vegan or a tregan. It's the bloody carcass of the adorable bunny-like creature you found. It's the piece of unstable ordnance you recovered from the shuttle wreck. The dialect translator is a small device. It is on. This is your athletic supporter. Without close inspection, you notice it to be well used. The Cubic's Room puzzle has made you look stupid more than usual. It looks like your average keycard. This is one of the unopened spores. The whistle is usual looking. You shove the unstable ordnance up a readily available orifice of the dead creature. You're a sick man, Roger. You can see a little guy across the clearing picking some sort of berries from a bush. You startle the odd little pink dude, causing him to bolt into the underbrush. Succeeded in establishing contact with one of this planet's life forms. That was unexpected. The thing exploded, taking you on a one-way trip to that great garden in the sky. If only it didn't look like a maze, you'd probably be able to think a bit more outside the box. This looks like the brains of the operation. The vines extend from the pulsating plant, almost like they're looking for something. You place the rabbit carcass on the sticky vine plant. nothing like a good explosion to brighten up your day. And you thought you'd have to navigate the maze like vines. That unstable ordnance sure made short work of this vine creature. There's nothing left you would want to take. That unstable...
No need to look for a secret passage anymore.
The grass here smells acidic, like there is some kind of caustic agent seeping into the ground here. Even if you did want to graze, all the vines here would get in your way. You see large, plump berries on the bank of bushes in this field. The berries hanging on the bush look quite juicy and smell very pungent. The berry... Ugh! You spit it up immediately! Nothing living could stand to have something this awful in its mouth. You snag some of the odoriferous red berries. The foliage here...
There's nothing of interest in that direction.
It's a cheetar. A cheetar centaur. Nah, only kidding. It looks dangerous, though.
The swamp water is mostly green. It must be reflecting the green of the canopy of leaves overhead.
Actually, it's more likely the algae. Those leaves are opaque, so they wouldn't reflect back to the water's surface. Now leave the narrating to me.
Just trying to help you out, Mr. Creepy Disembodied Voice that comments on everything I do? Seriously, don't badger me. You're badgering me. Badger, 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 mushroom, mushroom!
Snake? A snake? Nope, not a snake.
There's nothing of interest in that direction.
The trees here are slick and mossy. It smells like three different components. You can't quite place them. You take a deep, hearty gulp of the highly questionable water.
No, I don't.
The strange red berries pack a very pungent aroma. Nothing... You rub the berries all over your body. Now you smell like a walking ammonia inhalant.
Yuck!
The swamp monster attacks you with its slimy tentacles. Almost as suddenly, it spits you back out. You distinctly hear the sounds of aquatic gagging and retching. Evidently, you had a bad aftertaste from the berries. You'd rather not look at it. In fact, you're trying hard not to think about what must be living in it. Waterlogged and weather-beaten trees defy their environment in this murky place. It's like two-month-old toe cheese from an infected case of athlete's foot, wrapped in mildew with just a hint of spring rain air freshener. You have already done that, but your graphics card is so amazing that it rendered it before you could see, even if you have a really rubbish graphics card. even if you don't have a graphics card. Deep brackish water conceals an army of reptiles and parasites. Considering the countless barb-headed parasitic nasties you see popping in and out of the surface of the water, I'm gonna file that idea under bad. You'd rather not. Splish! Splash! Swish!
Come on, this is embarrassing! Can we do something else now? Well, just one more.
Splash! Splish! Splash! You have stepped into a deeper area of the swamp. You are forced to swim. You take a deep breath, filling your lungs to near bursting, and head for the depths below. The cave walls look to be made of rock. Eugh, tastes like moss. It smells like lichen. A small boulder with a glowing gem resting on it sits in this air pocket cavern. You take the glowing gem. Once again, you wisely take in a load of air and head below. To your amazement, you find yourself in an underwater cavern. The water is much cleaner here than in the swamp above. You have gotten out of the deep spot and are back on your soggy feet. You are in a lightly forested area. A large fissure nearby seems to lead straight down. This tree is both vibrant and strong, holding its healthy canopy of foliage up high. Rather than the kind of leaves you are used to seeing, this tree has long, thick green strands. Your experience as an amateur xenobotanist tells you that the sunlight must be highly radioactive. The slim foliage thus allows for photosynthesis that runs through natural filters, keeping the tree from poisoning itself with the sunlight that sustains it. No, I'm just kidding. You have no idea why the leaves are like that. The fissure appears to be very deep, with sheer sides. You can make out no detail as it darkens toward the bottom. This stump, rotted and bug-infested, is the final monument to a once strong tree. This tree is dead, and seems to be free of the slick secretions some of the others generate. You begin to shimmy your way up the snag. Crack! Ugh. Holy log jams, Batman, you almost bit the big one! It smells like wood. Did you think you could swing across the chasm with your tongue? The forest floor here is a less forgiving environment, as the rocky soil makes it impossible for the grass to survive everywhere. The darkening, multicolored hues in the sky suggest some unusual gases in the atmosphere.
It wasn't me.
Thank you. Perhaps you have been snared. Suspended above the ground, you are unable to move freely. After a while, the cerebral fireworks begin. Capillaries begin to burst under the strain. You pass out. Once again, time passes. And then, some more time passes. While unconscious, you have the strangest of dreams. You hallucinate that your name is Larry. You are wearing something known as a leisure suit, apparently made of fully synthetic materials and proven to generate large amounts of static electricity. While prowling a locale known as the Land of the Lounge Lizards, you spend your time badgering women of the area to participate in bizarre mating rituals such as... Just then, consciousness begins to creep in. Your head begins to clear and you realize that you have been imprisoned. Your captor appears to be that large oaf sitting near the fire. Creatures are genetically bred, rigorously trained to subdue the most threatening creatures in the universe, and he has captured you. He looks a little embarrassed about it.
Hi. My name's Roger. Roger Wilco. There's a... Obviously been some mistake here. Can you let me out of this cage?
The hunter stands and takes a long look in your direction. His face, though strange in its own right, bears an expression one might see on a freak show patron.
What are you going to do with me?
The hunter has decided that it's a perfect day for a barbecue. As he slowly turns you over the fire, you begin to turn a beautiful golden brown. Death follows at an agonizingly long distance.
Hi. My name's Roger. Roger Wilco.
You just keep getting creepier. From the looks of that fire, he plans to go the other way around. A skeleton hangs near the cage, a good indicator that this creature does not want you for your janitorial skills.
There's a... obviously been some mistake here. Can you let me out of this cage?
The hunter stands and takes a long look in your direction. His face, though strange in its own right, bears an expression one might see on a freak show patron. On impact with the ground, the spore opens and spews its dust into the air. The hunter falls to the ground, paralyzed. You reach through the bars and take possession of the key. This key looks to be made rather crudely. You slip the key into the lock and give it a turn. The lock snaps open. A rope hangs from the large tree. You grab the rope. this poor fellow must have gotten snuck up on. Even in death, he looks surprised. In the center, a campfire burns. One has to wonder about the purpose of a fire during a warm day such as this. You are at the edge of a forest. The boundary is a sheer cliff at the east side of the area. In the distance, you see a landing platform, possibly the one which welcomed you to this strange, lush world. You are at the edge of... You get dizzy just thinking about looking over the ledge.
The grass here, is it... It looks mowed! Big Scary Hunter likes to keep his front lawn all neat and pretty. What a girly man!
The grass here is trimmed and feels a bit rough. Something about the sweet-smelling grass tends to give you a headache. No matter where you try to taste the grass, you just can't bring yourself to eat it. It's a large bank of fungus. It's a large bank of fungus. It's a large... You don't want to collect them. It smells earthy, but uninteresting. You don't like mushrooms. It's a relatively short rope made from rough hemp. Gripping firmly with your legs, you tie the rope to the middle of the makeshift bridge. One chance too many, and he seized the opportunity, not to mention you. You are consumed in two quick bites. Gripping firmly with your legs, gripping firmly. You release your grip on the rope. This has a negative effect on your resistance to the urging of gravity. Gripping. Thank you. timing causes you to jump when... Dude... Gripping... Due to the unyielding nature of solid nothing happened. Gripping there is a mammoth member of the local fauna to the right. It looks to be in need of constant nourishment, hence the look being cast at you.
Hey buddy, I've gotten a bit fat and cheese-filled from my pampered space station lifestyle. Can you give me a hand?
The only response from it is a stomach growl.
Not even if you paid me.
You look hungry, buddy.
Huh? The monster looks annoyed. Maybe it can understand you. The encroaching darkness chokes off all light around you.
Could you possibly make that statement sound more ominous?
Maybe. That was just off the top of my head. How about this? The icy grip of darkness wraps you in an unyielding embrace, cutting you off from the light of safety. That better?
I suddenly have a need for my security blanket.
Really? Do you really have a security blanket? Or are you just trying to make me feel better?
I do. Just a little one.
You hear the sound of many small, scratchy footsteps moving towards you.
Ow!
Gnash! Growl! Crunch! Snap! You have just been felled by a killer cave beaver. You now know the meaning of excruciating when used in reference to level of pain. You don't need to use the... You don't need... You take out the gem and hold it in your palm. The room is illuminated by its glow. You hear a small shriek and the sound of many footsteps moving away from you. The cave seemed to glow with the light of the gem you're holding. Even when it's lit, this place smells dank and earthy. You don't have enough water to make mud pies. The ground below your feet disappears. You tumble down through the darkness. That was a rather spectacular entrance. All systems seem to be intact, though. The dwellers mumble something. Your translator responds.
Follow us, Beanpole.
Got it. This hideaway seems quite verdant. This hideaway... The sickly sweet smell of the grass on this planet is weak here. Desert winds blow dry air through this area constantly. The sick... You can find nothing worth nibbling. The rocks strewn across this area from a natural barrier to the north.
Welcome to our canyon. You look to be from out of town. On behalf of all of us, I would like to thank you for saving our compadre from the hunters. You are welcome to stay in the canyon as long as you like. When you are ready to leave, simply say the word and my assistants will show you the only way out for a being of your size. When you leave, however, we must seal the exit behind you for our own protection. Goodbye, and good luck.
The earth here looks soft. It smells like the feet of those pink creatures, pungent and nasty. You're on a strict hell no diet. When you want to eat something that could make you die, you just say hell no. Hell smells like a small pink dude. Let's not, okay? One large, uniquely shaped rock provides cover from the elements. The other rocks look pretty average.
Now, what was that word?
Gameplay note. You'll need to type the password into the translator. Enter, we'll close the translator. The little pink dudes just stare at you with their big buck-tooth smiles. Perhaps you need to be more specific.